Pierre Magistry. I come from California University for Communication. And this year I've been in TKU for Bootstrapping. I received some funding for the Bootstrapping Network of Taiwan. Many of you either knowledge or either experience about it. So I will try to be still very introductory. I won't go into any technical details. So basically my starting point is that if you want to have some human language technology, or if you want to do some linguistic research using large language data, we need some algorithms, some tools to process the data automatically. And most of these techniques require what we call lexical resources, which are databases that are made for computers to describe the language and not for the human. So among the applications you can think of, so among the various applications you can think of that require such resources, I can mention the input method, which rely on the large databases, or if you want to do data mining for digital humanities, which has become a fashionable research tool and new trend, we need automatic processing of the corpora, and for this we need lexical resources. The same goes if you want to move toward computer-aided language learning, especially with our techniques. You will need some databases that are not only meant to record the linguistic data, just like dictionaries, which are made for you, but also some resources that the computer can process. This is slightly different. So in computational linguistics, there is this very successful story, maybe you heard of it, the Princeton English Broadband, which was one of the first lexical networks that introduced the language data as a big graph, the database, and it's back from the 90s. And since then, it has been declined to many other languages, including Chinese and Japanese, and other kinds of lexical networks have been proposed. Network, which follow a slightly different methodology, and BabelNet, maybe I will talk a little bit later, which is a different project which try to connect all the other networks. So basically my research is topic is about what can we do for Taiwanese language if we want to have this kind of resource for Taiwanese, which I think need it. Where can we start? So here are some illustrations and some links if you want to be familiar with those physical resources you can check. So this is the first one, the Chinese Wallet. So for Chinese, we have the Chinese Wallet, which was created at Academia Sinica, and it's now hosted in NPU. And this is an extract from the open source project, the French Lexical Network, which is, I think, not yet officially online, but it's made out of messy. And so I mentioned BabelNet, which is the most recent project, and try to connect many, many kinds of data. Some are very linguistic, like the WorldNet, some are less linguistic. That's Wikipedia. So the BabelNet project tries to connect everything so that the computer can make the connection and use all the data based inferences. OK. Another important change in computational linguistics, linguistics in general, is that we hope that we can forward a more open data way to record language use and to record language resources, so that the database compiled can be used by other projects and can be linked to each other. Otherwise, if you just take a database on your computer and you don't share it, it's kind of useless. And for many applications, you need to draw from various different sources, so you need to, those networks to be connected to each other. And this is very similar to the new development of the so-called semantic web, which I cannot introduce it in technical experience. Basically, you know what is internet, what is a web, which is a network of documents that were made a human labor, for human. And the move towards the semantic web is to have a network of data that is meshed in labels, where the different server can exchange data. So all this move toward linguistically linked open data is going from the semantic web, drawing the inspiration from the semantic web to build lexical resources. And I'm really lucky that this year, I'm working in a W3C, which is the organism that is responsible for standardizing the web, just released a report and some guidelines to have some standard way of building the lexical resources. So now I'm trying to put my data into this format, into this standard, so it can be more easily connected to other resources. So for example, if you have this network for Taiwanese, you can directly connect it to existing network in French, in Chinese, and Japanese. And you can make inferences based on the other data. So I won't go into the details, but this is the schema of the W3C. So then I want to build one for Taiwanese. But if you look at how the various coordinates were built, even how the BabelNet project is conducted, it's all projects like multi-million euro projects that involve teams of lexicographers. So my strategy is to rely on existing dictionaries, because we have some good depth for Taiwanese, that we have quite a few very good dictionaries that are or are being digitized. So we can process them with a computer and extract some information in a way which is kind of text mining but for dictionary, to extract some formatted information readable by computers into a more comprehensive database. So what I do is that I use a computer to read the dictionary and I extract the dictionary and I try to map the traditional dictionary entries into a more formal way to describe lexical entries, the way it's done in modern lexical networks. So, I'm doing it automatically, so it cannot be as good as the Princeton ordinate or the Princeton français. And it will need some post-processing and some post-edition to be verified and to be evaluated. But this kind of networks, even if it's noisy, it contains some mistakes, it can still be useful for many automatic analysis and for many applications. So I think it's still worth doing it. I will add mostly for this year two sources of data. One is the Taiwanese language that's again by the Ministry of Education, which is from the beginning available as open data, so I just have to download the Excel files to into my database. And what I told you about CDN, as I will show you, which is a little bit more complicated to get it because it's in the process of being digitized. It will be made available on the resource hopefully, you can make it. So I added that on my
digitizing process, so then work on it. So basically, when you start, when you browse the dictionary, it's basically meant for human to read. And what I need is to extract, I bet it's quite easy for the institution of the industry of education. They have this entry, I can extract the reading, I can extract the part of speech, so some proper information. I have some relation link, like synonymy or antonymy, which allows me to draw the link to the network. And I can also perform some automatic analysis of the clauses, especially because here it's in Chinese. So we do have some like syntax to parse or instead of two for Chinese. For example, for Hong Kong, and I can infer that it's a kind of change. But I assure you that for the moment this kind of experiment has not been so successful for automatic parsing or using the expert information for this part. It's actually not so easy. And the other source is what I was asking. So this is a photo book picture from the dictionary. And what I have to do is to extract the information so I see that I have some Mandarin words which allow me to connect the resource to other network, like the Chinese word network, for example. I have this syntactic information about speech. And again, some definition in Mandarin with the Taiwanese translation. And for the Taiwanese part, I can extract the translation itself. I can extract the readings of the translation. And in this dictionary, I can extract many things like grammatical variant for like this, you get quite the information that this character can also be read another way. And there are plenty of things like this in the dictionary. And you have also the, you know, the tagalog, which has are some kind of links. So I know that there is a link between those words. It's somewhat less precise than but it's still useful to build a network and to draw some connection. So at the end, hopefully it should look like this. And this is an extract from the actual graph centered around the previous page of the dictionary. Well, you can see we draw the link and we can draw the dictionary not just as a list of entries, but as a multi-dimensional graph. This connection between the all the information. Yeah, so still a work in progress, always only have 2 months to go. So I will still be working on the data at the end of the year, and I will write the paper and release the data in January. My estimation is that the network should include around 30 to 40,000 lemma. Maybe what I this number in terms of relationship. And then I can move on to corpus analysis and connection from the lexical resources to the actual language resources. But I will need help for evaluation. So please contact me for the next
period, 20 years maybe, where people have been trying to define what it is. At the beginning, it was called minority languages or small languages, right? All bad words. So now people agree on under-resourced languages, which means languages try to do something with a language which doesn't have a dictionary, doesn't have a corpus, but also which doesn't have linguists, possibly, or not that many. That what probably at the moment hundreds of thousands of people working on English dictionaries, thousands of people working on Chinese dictionaries. How many people are there working on Taiwanese dictionaries, right? At the moment. So, less, I assume. In addition, there is the question of low prestige, right? If you say you write your master thesis on Chinese, everybody would say, yeah! If you write your master thesis on Taiwanese, they would say, oh, I don't get very far.
Bruce will say yes.
Yeah, that's the reality. Then Pierre discusses some, or introduces, or talks about methods, right? With minority languages, small languages, under-resourced languages, you cannot use any method because you don't have the resources, right? If you have tons of dictionaries incorporated, you can use, of course, the best method, but with the best results. But if you work in this area, you have to look what kind of resources do you have and what's the method I can apply. Even if it's not the very best method, the very best result is probably the only way to do. Therefore, maybe this bootstrapping idea. And finally, what we didn't talk about, but I saw in the abstract and I found very interesting, is the way you model things in the meaning text theory or meaning to text theory. So this is very interesting. I would just consider everybody to look into that. It's not very well known in Taiwan, in Asia at all. Right? Meaning text theory has been developed by Melchior. Melchior tried to escape from Russia. Because he had signed a petition, he escaped to Canada. So it's known in Canada, partially in France, because he was in Montreal and worked on French. So, but it's a very intelligent way of organizing a dictionary into a network. Right? So if you are working on dictionaries, interesting, so it's worth to look into Melchior, and we should be grateful to Pierre to apply this to Taiwanese, and probably we'll talk about it in future presentations more on Taiwanese and